Welcome to the France 24 Observers. This show is based on our network of observers. They're ordinary people who tell us what's going on where they are and send in photos and videos to document it. We check it all here in Paris, bring the best to you. We begin with oil spills, not in the Gulf of Mexico, but in West Africa, the Niger Delta, where they've been happening for nearly 50 years. The biggest foreign oil company in the region is Shell. They say that 90% of the spills come from sabotage by local guerrilla groups. That's not what our observer says. We head to the Niger Delta with Nimo Basse.
There's been a lot of media focus on the Gulf of Mexico. The same media has conveniently forgotten about what the oil corporations from the United States and from Europe are doing in Nigeria. In Nigeria, according to official information, there are about 300 oil spills every year. We've also got it on record that there are over 2,000 oil spill sites that need response. To get the figures about how many barrels have been released is very difficult, because even local people complaining about the spills are being harassed by security agencies. Many of the very dramatic cases are situations where a lot of spills are poured into either the swamp or the forest, and then the spill is followed by a fire. So what you see is a devastated landscape with burnt out trees and then rivers whose colors have completely changed. All these are big environmental challenges for people who depend directly on the environment. The basic reasons why we have so much oil spill here is that there's often equipment failure. Up to 80% of the spills occurring are due to equipment failure. International Oil Corporation prefer to always claim that spills are caused by sabotage and don't have to pay compensation. So it's just an excuse that there should be an international tribunal for environmental offenses.
It's summer here in the Northern Hemisphere, and in the southwestern United States, that means wildfire season. Our next observer had the bad luck to live just a few hundred meters from the latest fire. It was probably started by a careless camper. We head to Flagstaff, Arizona, with Charlie McCallie.
We actually had to be evacuated from our home. They said we had 1 minute to get out of our home. We couldn't grab anything except our kids and our dog. Hit the road as fast as we could to get away from the fires. And then I actually shot the video the following night. The fire continued to grow. I went and stayed at my brother's house, who also lives in Flagstaff. And he and my nephew and I climbed the mountain that night. And as a photographer with all the gear that I have, I shot a time-lapse footage for 15 minutes, just taking exposures over and over again. And then I just put those all together and added the music to it to make the video. So. It was very powerful being there, just seeing the flames on the mountain like that. We were saying to each other, this is a once-in-a-lifetime thing that we'll see a mountain range on fire like this.
Now to Beirut, Lebanon. It's a cosmopolitan city. People speak all kinds of languages, French, Arabic, English. When they get together, they'll say, hi, kifak, sava. But does this mean their beautiful Arabic is in danger? That's what our next observer says. We head to the Lebanese capital with Suzanne Talouk, a language activist.
Young people today are ashamed of speaking Arabic. They think their own mother tongue isn't cool. We decided to start a public awareness campaign in the streets of Beirut. People were surprised to see Arabic letters on the ground lying there like bodies, with a message around them saying, don't kill your language. The campaign was designed to protect the Arabic language and at the same time promote our Arabic language festival. We organized it with the help of the Arab Thought Foundation. It was the first of its kind. And it was a big success.
That's it for this week. As always, you can find more reports from our observers on our website. See you next time.